compounding taxpayer is only composition dealer, so that is quarterly return. There is a return for ISD, which we discussed. It is on 15th of the subsequent month. There's a return for TDS. There are some transactions which could be subject to tax called tax deducted. So it's part of GST. There is still no notification on what transactions will be subject to TDS as of now. There's an annual return which needs to be filed by 31st December. And then the final return is only when there's a cancellation of registration. So these are broad returns which are required to be filed. So GSTR 1, 2, 3 and 9 are mandatory for every business. So therefore, these are highlighted here. So this is the manner of matching which we discussed in the previous slide, that when the vendor submits the details, we need to accept or reject. And these are the timelines which are there here. So we can just skip this. So payments are all common across all the states. 20th is the due date for payment. So we need to enable our IT systems to handle the payments, the filing of the returns and everything. Waybills are being, the GST law per se has deferred waybills, but respective states have been given the powers to manage the waybill generation and rules relating to waybills. And each of the states are releasing their waybill rules, and AP has done that recently. Telangana has not yet done that. Statutory forms are done away with. Refunds are available in two situations under GST law. One is when you export any goods or services. Second is wherever there's an inverted duty structure, which means your tax rate, output rate is lesser than your input rate, in which case you will have credit balance, which you cannot use. And therefore, a refund would be granted in that situation. So these are the key action items. Get all the registration and IDs and passwords for GST. Sharing those registration to the stakeholders. Customer and vendor details updation. And impact assessment, obviously. And do the vendor negotiation. These are all the documents which are required under GST and a different situation. So invoice is basically whatever invoice format you have today, we have to see whether that invoice format is in line with GST law and make those changes in the format. Debit notes and credit notes, again, today we may just issue a debit note or a credit note whenever we want to pass on some discount or we want to revise the price, etc. Post GST, each invoice or each debit note has to be linked to the invoice. It cannot be random. And it cannot be ad hoc. It has to be linked to the invoice, and each invoice can have only one debit note or a one credit note. So therefore, this is very important. Whenever we receive advance, there's a document which we need to issue called receipt voucher. Again, there is a specific format for this, and we need to follow that format. And then, of course, returns. Returns are very complicated, and therefore, our IT has to be totally prepared for handling, you know, return related compliances. Otherwise, a lot of work will have to be done manually, and there could be errors given that this is a new law. And yeah, the P&L account has to be maintained state wise at least for MIS purposes, or at least for handling GST related compliances, because under the GST law we also need to reconcile what we are reporting in the returns with the financials, and so therefore it becomes important for us to have something state level to prove that. So this is broadly what it is, and I would be happy to take questions. Yes. Yeah.
The relationship in terms of the incidence of tax.
Yeah.
Okay. Now take a situation where there's a collaboration. Okay. And there's a foreign collaboration. There is a foreign investor.
Okay.
And from him, there are parts which are being supplied to India to manufacture.
Okay.
Now, will that be called a close relationship to determine what is the real value of the product?
So whether it will be falling under related party transaction.
Exactly, that's right.
About. Yeah. So collaboration is what kind of collaboration, sir?
It is both equity participation as well as technology know-how.
Yeah.
as well as supply of certain critical parts.
Okay.
All the
okay.
things.
Okay. So there is a definition for related party under the GST law, and whenever there's an equity participation, they are considered to be related parties.
Equity participation.
Yeah, yeah.
If equity is not there, need not
if
be.
If equity is not there and yeah. it is only technology collaboration,
yes.
then it may not be.
I see, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. So what happens in fact then in that kind of situation,
so,
how the valuation is done?
So in that case, the valuation will be done. So today also under customs law, we have something called special valuation. Wherever there is a import from related parties, they see whether the price at which you are importing is at an arm's length, which is a very, very technical term under the law, which they call. It is a fair value. If the same entity is selling to some other party in India, whether the same price will be applicable or there is a reduction, or whether that reduction is justifiable, there could be a reduction because like volume discount could be there or something else could be there. If you are able to prove that the price is at a fair value, then fine, and you will end up paying custom duty and
yeah.
IGST on that and proceed with your procurements. But if it is not, then they will add the value to, you know, differential value to that value, and you'll have to pay GST on the additional amount.
Okay, this first question. Second question is, you have said that is the IGST.
Yeah.
As such, when you pay it on the imports, that cannot be claimed as a credit.
Yes, so...
But whereas later on you made a mention that IGST can be claimed in all the transactions
yeah.
as a credit.
Yeah. So in that case, see, I am talking about two situations here, sir. One situation is wherever you are, your business, your output is zero. There is no tax on that. There's no GST on that. So electricity is outside GST. So wherever you're generating electricity, you have some procurements on which you're paying IGST or any GST, you cannot take credit of that. Wherever you are manufacturing or doing, you know, manufacturing, say, devices for electricity generation, which is taxable, say, at 5%, then in that case, when you incur IGST, that can be taken as credit.
So wherever there is no tax on the output, you cannot pay.
Yes.
If there is a tax on the output, you can pay.
Yes, absolutely.
Madam, you rightly mentioned about the composite supply and mixed supply. For the EPCs, rooftop solar solution, which is a which comes under the composite supply or mixed supply, and is there any impact on the GST on the panel, which will be separate, GST on the inverter will be separate, GST on the in that fabrication will be separate. What exactly
yes.
the impact of the GST
yeah.
on this?
Yeah. So what happens is, I'll just give you an example of both composite and mixed supply otherwise, you will have to help me decide whether it is a composite supply or mixed supply in solar panels case. Okay, so composite supply is in a situation where it is naturally bundled, means any transaction, like suppose we take this, you know, this hall, we get all this equipment, this furniture, chairs, tables and the whole equipment together. Right, so this is a composite supply for us. Whether they should treat it as renting of this convention hall or this equipment, both of them are subject to different rates. But it is naturally bundled. When someone is buying or taking this service, they expect both of them to be given together. In which case, what happens is under the GST law, it will be treated as composite supply. And mixed supply is totally unrelated. We go to a store, we buy toothpaste, we get soap free, for example. So they're mixed supply, they're not at all connected. You buy, normally you buy them separately. It is an offer and it is something, a pack, a combi pack that being given together to promote their sales. So these are the two concepts. Now what is the tax treatment in both these cases? Composite supply, in composite supply, you have to decide what is the principal portion of supply in that. For example, we give a car for our regular servicing, okay? So what happens in that, there is an element of service, there is an element of goods in that. If they put some spare parts or some oil or some, you know, lubricants, etc. But there is a major element of service. 90% of the cost that they incur is towards servicing through labor. Only 10% is towards that oil or lubricant that they're using. In which case, the principal portion of supply becomes that part, whichever is getting supplied. And the rate is applicable, whatever is applicable to that part, You have to treat the whole contract as per that rate and charge GST. Okay, so that is how the treatment will differ. As far as mixed supply is concerned, then what they do is you have to decide which is the highest rate in the total combination of products and pay GST on that. So in your case, I'm presuming it is a composite supply, not a mixed supply, because it is all supply of module and fabrication, etc. In which case, we have to decide what is the principal portion of supply. If you have three or four types of products in that, you have value of fabrication in that, or any other service element in that, we need to decide what is the principal portion of supply, what is the rate applicable to that, and then charge GST accordingly.
Yeah.
So one way of doing it is the value, sir. Whichever value is the highest in that, you consider that. You have, I mean, that is the practical way of doing it. The law does not define that, but that is.
Actually, adding to the same question, like I will simplify it.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah, I know these situations are there where you have exactly 50-50%. So what do you do with that? So in that case, we have to see how is it, what is the perception of that product in the market? How does a customer perceive that product as? Okay, and based on that, you have to consider. In the slide you're talking about? Solar generating? Next slide.
It's there. On the same slide.
This one only, yeah. No? Solar generating system and solar based device.
C. B and C.
Yeah, solar power plant generating system, right?
We are charging, like the same question, we are charging 5% to our existing customers by going to this GST regime. But the thing is, like the same question I was having, so now I got the answer, like we have to charge 5% based on all the services and whatever panels and modules, inverters we provide to our customer. So that is this, right? Another question is, like we also do manufacture these solar water heaters. So previously ETC tubes we were importing, like somebody was importing and we were buying from that because of some pricing issue and storage issue. But now in GST regime 28% tax has been added. So how we can get the tax benefit of that? Like I have to buy from the importer or importer will charge me some 5% like service charge or something, or I have to import it so that I'll get a tax benefit of it.
See, can you just repeat what were you doing earlier?
Earlier I was buying from importer and that duty was, there was no duty because it was exempted. Now 28% duty, okay, has been there.
Yeah.
So now he is importing and he is charging me whatever amount or whatever duty he is paying. But as a product, I am paying 5% GST on my product. Mm. So I want to take that tax credit.
Okay.
So I have to import it, or I can take a tax credit by taking from importer.
So I think it is neutral whether you import directly or you buy from him, because if he's importing today, he's only clearing the goods from the customs.
Yes, clearing, he's paying everything.
He's only paying everything, right? Yeah. So BCD, if you import and he imports, he will pay the same BCD, right? So that is neutral. Now what is he doing is, he is additionally charging, say, his margin of 5%,
yes,
correct? On which he is charging GST additionally.
Yes.
Which you will be able to take credit.
Okay.
So it is a neutral situation in that case, whether you import directly or whether you buy. So it becomes more a commercial call.
Okay. Thank you.
High C sale, the concept is still not yet clarified under GST law. The view is high C sale, on high C sale today, there are no taxes. Even under GST, there will not be any taxes. But what happens is, whoever is selling to you, or you're talking about your sale on high C, or you're buying on high C?
No, I'm buying on high
C. You're buying on high C. So what happens is, to your vendor, whatever the turnover in relation to high C sale made to you, that may become an exempt turnover in which case he will have to reverse his credits to that extent.
Okay. Can we avoid the GST?
Yeah, you can avoid the GST. Avoid GST only to the extent of his margin. On ultimately, when you're importing the product, you will have to pay a custom duty and IGST. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yes, it is. Okay. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Correct. Your understanding is right. Sir, composition vendor, now under GST, what happens? Anybody whose turnover is below 20 lakhs, they are not required to come under GST at all. They will not be registered. Anybody more than 20 lakhs, but less than 75 lakhs turnover, they can be under a scheme called composition scheme, where they will not be required to pay tax at 18%, 28% and all. He will only charge 1% tax or 2.5% tax based on whether he's manufacturing or only trading. And then he will raise an invoice on you.
I have a question. In the solar power generating system, there are many components that form a solar power generating system. In this GST document, there is no clarity on the different components.
Okay.
So it says spare parts used in the manufacture of. Now, how do you establish that it is only for manufacturing company? For example, solar power generating system has a solar inverter. Now, as a trading company, I can import an inverter.
Yeah.
As an EPC company, somebody can import an inverter.
Yeah.
Now, how do you say this is established that this comes under 5%?
I'm not clear on your
question. Solar power generating system.
Yeah.
It mentions all the parts which are used under the manufacture of these things are at 5%.
Yes.
Now,
how do you establish that inverter has been used only for this purpose?
Will be used for that purpose. That can be established.
Yeah.
But how do you? There is no specific mention that solar inverter is at 5%.
Okay.
So tomorrow, there are instances where customs is clearing at 5%, and certain ports they are saying it is 28%. So there is no clarity. So how do we get this clarity?
If your business is only into this, into manufacture of solar devices, then we should. I know there are practical challenges. Explain to the officers that this, because I am into this business, I am going to use this into this manufacture only. That is more a practical challenge, I would think. And there is nothing defined in the law to say, this is a solar inverter or this is not a solar inverter.
Yeah.
They have given exemption to this sector. Okay, and saying that if you are manufacturing any products in relation to these, then you will get an exemption.
So if I'm not manufacturer, I'm a trader.
Yeah.
Then?
You'll not get this.
Okay. So then...
because it is for the manufacturer.
Then nowhere else it is mentioned under solar inverter. So how do they evaluate this?
So you want to just be an EPC contractor, buy inverter and supply to a solar company. Your situation?
No, we are a distribution company.
Distribution company.
Yeah. So we buy panels, we buy inverters. So we sell in, we resell it.
Okay.
So how does the customs officer look at this? See, I can convince him saying that solar inverter can be used only for a solar power generating system.
One option is that there is a scheme called advanced ruling mechanism.
Okay.
Where we can go to the GST council or the advanced ruling authority, they will constitute very soon. We can make an application and say that our business is this and we believe this is the rate because this is a solar inverter and therefore please give us a rate, concessional rate.
Okay, so it has to go for an advanced ruling,
yeah.
But which is not yet existing still.
No, not yet.
Okay, thank you.
I do transaction management services for some European investors who buy the projects from European companies. The sellers, and the projects are located in Europe. So GST may not be applicable because the point of sale is somewhere else. And I do project for Indian companies, again transaction management services, for which I need to pay GST. Can I get this GST refunded because I do export service also?
Yes, you can.
Is there any linkage on the quantum?
So suppose in your case, say 75% of your turnover is towards export.
Yeah.
25% is towards your local customers in India.
Yeah.
Whatever credit you have,
yeah,
you can use it for your GST liability to your Indian customers, whatever you have to pay on account of your revenue from GST Indian customers. Remaining portion, you can claim it as a refund.
But for 75%, there is no credit, you know?
No, there is a credit available.
Okay.
Because your activity is totally taxable.
Yeah.
But you're exporting and therefore you're not paying GST.
Right.
Yeah. So you can take 100% credit. There is
okay.
No issue on that.
Thank you.
In power generating system,
yeah,
especially in off-grid, the government has put this battery into 28 slab,
yeah,
28% slab. So if I purchase a battery at 28% and I combine the system and sell it at a 5%,
yeah,
what will happen that about that 23%?
So that is called the inverted duty structure, uh-huh, what we are talking about. So your output is taxable at 5%, your input is taxable at 28%. So you have a lot of credit balance which will remain at the end of the year that you can claim a refund from the government. Yes. That is as per the law which is there, because it is because extra tax you have paid, your output is only liable to at 5%. So therefore it is there in the law. There are the refund is contemplated in two situations, like I was telling. One is in the export situation, second is inverted duty structure. So this is there even in pharma sector today. Their formulations are all covered under 5% or 12% category, but all the APIs that they procure at 18%. So they're going to get a refund of the outstanding credits.